heard Deacon Denise say that we were on God's wake-up list. And Jesus, the Christ of God, was on the wake-up list. And it is on the third day when Jesus rose from the dead. Amen. Glory to God. So it's at this point in time of the service where we get to continue in our praise and continue in our worship. It is in our area of our ability to give in our tithe and in the offering. If you're mailing and you're giving today, you can mail it to P.O. Box 302 here in Davenport, Florida, 33837. And if you're giving by way of Cash App, the ministry address or the handle is the $HCMILIFE. Again, the $HCMILIFE. If you have your Bibles, we'll ask you to return to the book of Acts. And it's in the 20th chapter, especially those that are viewing the channel today, we welcome you this morning. But in Acts chapter 20, and this is in the New American Standard Bible, in verse 35, the scripture says, "In everything, I showed you that by working hard in this way, you must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, that he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive." We like to build up faith when as it relates to our giving, because we believe that the word of God is how we act. It should give us faith to believe in our giving. If we have faith to believe in our healing, we can have faith to believe in our giving as well. This passage of scripture was written by the Apostle Paul, and this was his farewell letter. His farewell speech to the believers that were in the church at Ephesus. And he was teaching them to remember their service by, he was acknowledging the cultural norms of the day. And the cultural norms of that day in Rome was to accumulate as much wealth as you can get. Not only to accumulate as much wealth as you can get, but also get as much honor that you could get. But our mindset today, even in this day and age of 2024, is that we're challenged by this verse. And that Jesus says that it is more blessed to give than to receive. That we should have this feeling of joy, a feeling of fulfillment. And if you're giving today and you don't have that type of response, if you are sad about your giving or discontent about separating yourself from your money, then keep it. I'd much rather you keep your money until you get your heart right. And then when you get your heart right as it relates to why you're giving and having the joy in giving, then come. And then give. Because God says that he loves a hilarious, a giver, a person that enjoys, that has a laughter or a joy about themselves and their giving. Anybody glad about giving this morning? Again, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And if we, do you think about that? If we all follow that principle, then not only would we be giving, but we also would be receiving. How many know that money don't grow on trees? And that God uses mankind to be able to give into the heart of others. And so when you give into the ministry, you help us to continue this gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? If you're ready to give, you can stand to your feet. Glory to God. So we just want to have a heart to be able to serve, a heart to be able to give back unto God what rightfully belongs to him. Amen. The basket is being passed around now, amen, that you can give your heart's desire. Glory to God. Savings plan, whatever accounts they have set aside, their investments. You've made made an investment in us by giving us your Son and the Holy Spirit. And we pray, Father, that you will always get a great return on our behalf. And it's for that we give you praise and much thanksgiving. And it is in Jesus' name. And all of the church of God said, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. Glory to God. We were now to do our confessions towards our giving. We speak to our seed, our funds freely given, and command them to go prosper the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. May it grow, multiply, and return to us in abundance. And it's in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Praise God.
Hallelujah.
You may be seated. Amen. Glory to God.
Well, come on and bless his name this morning.
Set your hearts towards heaven this morning to be able to receive the ministry gift that the Lord has for us today. Amen. Praise God.
Transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed.
our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and we believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. The scriptures declare that we shall be saved if we have confessed with our mouth, if we believed in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. Scriptures declare that when we make that confession and we believe it in our heart, that our names are written in the Lamb's book of life. I don't know about anybody that's here this morning, but is anybody glad this morning that their names are written in the Lamb's book of life? I think about what the Master has done for us, and I have a sense of gratitude. This has been our foundational scripture throughout the year, regardless of what day that it is. And it's in the Passion Translation Bible in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 25. We're going to jump right into the scriptures today because I know some of you have hams in the oven and some of you have got dinner plans and what have you, but I'm going to give you your breakfast this morning.
Yeah,
amen. Right. Yes, in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 25, ready. Read. Set your gaze on the path before you with fixed purpose, looking straight ahead. Ignore life's distractions. I think it is worthy of being said again. Ready, read. Set your gaze on the path before you with fixed purpose, looking straight ahead. Ignore life's distractions. We've been talking about here in the last few weeks that two of the greatest distractions that we have in life is our finances and our health. And we believe, God, that on this resurrection day that we will hear from heaven today. You know, this day, I was thinking earlier that how, you know, we give a lot of attention to the time of Christmas. We exchange gifts and, you know, we put up lights and put up trees and we have parties and all those type of things. And I don't think we give enough recognition to Resurrection Day. We don't give enough recognition to Easter. We should be having parties. We should be exchanging gifts, because without the resurrection, we wouldn't even be here today. And so I look forward to rejoicing with you today and sharing this gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, last week, we went over this time frame of Palm Sunday, and it was during a time of Holy Week. And last week, when we looked at it, we saw where God's Word began to paint this picture for us, allowing us to see through the lens of Holy Writ time and space. You know, over 2,000 years ago, 7 days ago, if you can place your time in that time frame, it was during the time of Holy Week. And we observed from an imaginary viewpoint. Will you say that with me? Imaginary viewpoint. The painting of the Word of God crying the prophetic chant
located in Matthew chapter 21, praising Jesus Christ, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And we recognize and we saw where Jesus was riding a donkey into the holy city. And we had asked that you would just look in your mind's eye to be able to see what this looked like in your mind. And so again, over 2,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago and 3 days, if you will, they killed him. They said, let his blood be upon us and upon our children and our children's children. And there is this phrase that's varied, if you will, and it is a bit applicable here, and it says this simply. It says that if you live for the praise, you'll die for the criticism. If you live for the praise of others, you're going to die for them, for their criticism. And being in this position of servant leadership, anybody that's ever been in a position of leadership, you would know that this phrase is true.
Yes.
That if you live for the praise, you will perish from the criticism.
Amen.
But and I would like to add here, Selah. I want you to think about it. I want you to pause and consider.
Yes, sir.
But Jesus, the Christ of God, he did not live for the praise of men, and surely he did not die from the criticism. He laid his life down.
Come on.
The Bible says, no greater love than this, than a man will lay down his life for his friends. Now, you already know about the events that have taken place of Christ's crucifixion. We've seen the movie, the Passion of the Christ, and we see this riveting picture, this movie of Jesus' death on the cross on a hill far away. Stood an old, rugged cross. Not only did Mary, the mother of Jesus, mourn for her son, but also creation mourned for its architect. It mourned for its creator. This Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, is a visionary event. This helps us in understanding the vision that we've been teaching about for this ministry. Again, Resurrection Sunday is a visionary event that transformed the course of human history, offering us a new perspective on life and eternity of living this resurrected life. How many of us know that once we became born again, we begin to live this resurrected life? Remember the picture again that we painted last week of the honor and the majesty that was being poured out by the people on Jesus. They were laying down their palms. They were laying down their coats before him and after him. And they were pouring out their heart and they were lifting up their voices in praise. But the adoration for him was short-lived. It was short-lived, but with fixed purpose, Jesus looked beyond the cross of our afflictions. He looked beyond the cross of our shame, looked beyond the cross of our lack, beyond our insufficiencies and lack. And from an elevated cross, he cried, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The ones who glorified him are now the same ones who killed him.
Yeah.
They crucified him. Here in current day 2024, in out of our own grief, out of our own anger, out of our own disappointments, sadly, many of us are still crucifying him. Many of us are still pointing fingers at him on the cross. He didn't live up to our expectations, so he's not the one. I can hear the argument in that day. You know, we're still underneath the thumb of Rome. And today we're still underneath the thumb of a government. We're still underneath the thumb of debt. We're still underneath the thumb of sickness and disease. And yet you say that you're our king. You had the audacity to stroll into Jerusalem riding on a donkey with the winds of Holy Scripture saying, lift up ye gates, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come. No, crucify him.
Come on, that's what
he you did not live up to my expectation. You didn't come through for me.
Don't you know I lost my job? I lost the house. Okay, it was my foolishness. I get that. But do you know, Jesus, I almost lost my mind. But if you say you are who you say you are, why didn't you, Jesus, do something about it? Don't you see my suffering? If I could offer a bit of warning, whatever you do, don't charge God falsely.
That's right.
Are you sweating blood yet? Have you felt the pain of cat o' nine tails strewn with pieces of glass and metal across your back? Are you experiencing the flesh being ripped from your body? And until then, go sit in the corner.
Jesus.
Have an adult timeout. You know, we send kids to the corner to time out. Sometimes as an adult, you need to go to the corner and sit down and shut up.
Amen.
And until you get your act together, then come and talk to me.
Yes, sir.
The Via Della Rosa. Minister Denise, it was the ticket off of the planet for Jesus to get back to the Father.
My God.
He was waiting beyond the gates of glory. This term Via Dolorosa, it is the Latin word for the way of grief.
Yes, sir.
Or the way of suffering.
Yes.
Again, it was the path that Jesus walked on his way to his crucifixion. Marked by the nine stations of the cross, each representing events that occurred during his journey to Golgotha, where he was crucified. When you tell somebody that, tell your neighbor that the cross wasn't the end. The cross was not the end. Jesus, he not only saw beyond my faults, but he saw the glory that he once had with the Father. Can we just see past our current situation? Can we do that? Can we envision the resurrected life? I want you to remember this presence. And this presence is simply this, is that when he died, we died. And even greater, that when he rose, we rose. To live this resurrected life, I want you to know, child of God, that you're not alone. I remember growing up in the church, and he said, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Y'all were in the Baptist church. I can tell y'all been seeing some Baptist hymns. But we're not in this life alone. We come to the garden with him. Remember, we're in a co-partnership with Christ. I want to look at a story today. It's a long narrative, but I want the narrative to tell the story. Again, we've all known what happened before his crucifixion. We know what happened when he died. We see that he raised from the dead on the third day. But I want to look at a story shortly here. And I can tell you in advance it is a long scripture, but I want this scripture to speak for itself. And it is about this resurrected life. It's about being on a road of life. And recognizing that there's some things that we're missing along the way because we've become blinded to the pressures of life. And it's Jesus on the road to Emmaus. I'll ask if you turn your Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, and it's verses 13 through 35. It's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. I want you to soak in. I want you to be able to grasp the scriptures this morning. And it's in Luke chapter 24. And in Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 13, and behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs. And they talked together all of these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near. Hear that. Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Verse 16, very important. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. You know that will preach by itself right there. And he said unto them, what manner of communication are these that you have one with another? As you walk in a sad? Imagine that. And the one of them whose name was Cleopas, answering, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem? And hast thou not known the things which are come to pass in these days? And he said unto them, what things? And they said unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet mighty indeed in word before God and all the people. Verse 20 says, and how the chief priests and all of our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death, and we have crucified him, Verse 21. But, pay attention, 21. But, verse 21, pay attention. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel.
Come on.
I'm sorry, I have to read that verse again. Verse 21. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yet certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre. Verse 23. And when they found not his body, they came saying they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not.
Come on.
Then Jesus speaking. Then he said, he said unto all fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Yes, sir.
Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and enter into his glory? Verse 27, I will ask if you would read verse 27 through 31 with me. Ready? Read. And beginning at Moses and all of the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh into the village whither they went. And he made as though he would have gone further. Verse 29. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. Verse 30. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to them. Come on, y'all. Verse 31. Ready? Read. And their eyes were opened and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The road to Emmaus. Yes, these two disciples, they are walking and they are talking with Jesus after his resurrection. They knew of the recent events, but they didn't know that the King of Glory, the risen Savior, was among them.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That there is this, there is this thing called perception. That too often our perception is often off kilter. It's off balance. There's this perception versus reality.
Yes, sir.
We fight with this term every single day. What we're perceiving and what's actually real. Perceptions like Cleopas. And you know what? So there are these two disciples, but the Bible only tells us that their name is Cleopas. And you know, we could very well insert our name there.
All right.
There was Cleopas and Dave.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Cleopas and Dave, he was on the road to Emmaus. Our perception, it can blind us.
Yes,
it can withhold vital information, keeping us from the blessing. If we don't perceive properly.
That's right.
There are times in our lives of our inability to recognize Jesus at first. It can be clouded by our own expectations and our own misunderstanding.
Yes, sir.
Many times we don't see one like unto the Son of God, like the three Hebrew boys. That there was one that was like unto the Son of Man in the fire.
Yes, sir.
Many of us are going through these tumultuous times in our lives, but we don't realize that there's one that's in the fire with us. Like these two men on the road to Emmaus, they didn't even know who Jesus was. How can you not? And they were disciples.
Come on.
They walked with him. They talked with him. And yet they did not even know who he, they didn't even recognize his voice. The reality is that vision is our spiritual sight to see beyond the surface and recognize the presence of Christ in our lives. You know, our Christian life, our Christian journey is like this many times, where we become distracted by grief and blinding disappointments in life. Anybody ever been there? When our faith begins to dim because the pressure is just too great. We begin to deny him. We begin to act like we never knew him. When our faith has been shaken to the core, when this resurrection life seems to be just a bit too much. I remember that Jesus, just a few days prior, he said to Peter, he said, Simon,
yes, sir.
Behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat, Peter.
Yes, sir.
But I pray
for thee that thy faith, or what you believe, or what you perceive, fail not.
Yes, yes.
And when you're converted, when you come to yourself, when you recognize who you are and who I am, when you come to yourself, strengthen your brethren.
Yes, sir.
I know the pressures of life that are on you. I know that you have some mental issues that you've been dealing with. But when you come to yourself,
yes, sir.
Jesus. Strengthen your brethren. In other words, teach them the word. What does the word of God have to say about my situation?
Come on.
We need to look at the importance of knowing the scriptures. Yeah, listen, school was in session. School was in session at Emmaus Road University.
Come on.
School was in session. I do have a public service announcement. I know we have some teachers among us, but and they will attest to this, that during a test, the teacher does not talk during the test. There is silence from the teacher when a test is going on. So we must needs pay attention while we're walking this road of life, living this resurrected life. Hunt your neighbor and tell them, pay attention, because there's no talking during the test.
Come on.
It wasn't until later that revelation showed up. How many times has it been in your life when you have this scripture and you begin to stand on it, but you say, I don't fully understand it yet. But as life goes on, then you begin to understand the revelation of the word. We don't always get it right away.
Come on.
That's right.
That's good.
Even this teaching today, you might be thinking, okay, I didn't get all of that, so I got to plug into the YouTube channel. I got to play it over again so I can listen to what the pastor was talking about, what he was teaching. I need further. Listen, I need revelation.
Yeah.
Just because I'm teaching it to you don't mean that I've got the full scope.
Yes, sir.
God is always revealing his word on this road to Emmaus. Again, the university that we're seeing God's word being unveiled before us. That's why it's so important that parents, that you teach your children the word of God.
Yes.
How many of you see your own children in yourself?
Yes,
you see the road that they're going down. You say, wait, son, come here. Let me talk to you. Dad, you don't know nothing. Let me talk to you. Come here. Little girl, let me tell you. Come here. Let me explain to you that there's a road that you're going down that you don't want to go. I know every last parent in here sees something in their kid that's something that you used to do.
Exactly. Sometimes you got to come in. Yeah, come on,
Simon. You might not want to hit them these days because the court system's a little different today.
Flashback.
You know, it worked for me. There's a switch that was in the corner. There was a belt that I feared. But listen, today we've got to be able to love our children.
Yes.
We've got to correct our children.
Yes.
You see them going down a road that you have to say, wait, baby, come here. Let me talk to you.
Uh-huh.
You see yourself, Pete.
Yep, that's it.
You see your son. You see it.
See it.
You better do something about it now.
Yes,
right.
Yes, yes.
I know you.
Amen.
School is in session.
Yes, sir.
Again, it wasn't until later that the revelation,
that's good,
the understanding of what it was that Jesus was saying came to mind.
Yes.
Scriptures have to marinate.
Yeah.
Pastor Carol's an excellent cook. And I've noticed that there are certain times when she's cooking that she's preparing for the next day.
Yeah.
And she put things together and after she finished cooking, she said, no, let it sit. That there's sometimes I have to wait till the next day, but you have to let it marinate.
Listen,
she make the best mac and cheese on the planet. But let me explain something. It's not to the next day.
Yes.
That mac and cheese is so good. I thought it was good the day after, but the day after, once it marinated, everything began to set.
Yes, sir.
How many of you know that's good to eat? And that's how the word of God should be to us. Don't just take in what you're getting today. And everybody knows that Pastor David is not really a big fan of leftovers.
Yeah.
But I'm learning. I'm getting better in that area.
Yeah.
Amen, amen. Because I began to think about how the word does that. The word, it gets gooder.
Yes.
Yes. And gooder.
Yes.
When we commune and we begin to break bread with the Lord.
Yes.
The scriptures will begin to open our eyes to recognize his presence. That our vision becomes clear to us, that the purpose and the plan that God has for our lives, that like a focus, like a camera lens, that it begin to come into focus.
Hey, glory.
And I begin to learn and realize that the vision is not just about me. Matter of fact, the vision is never about me. The vision is greater than me. You know, just recently, I had to go to the doctor, and they wanted to check my eyes. They said that the pressure in my eyes were too high. You know there's high blood pressure? Well, I was not aware there's something called high eye pressure. And then what they test for glaucoma. And what happened is they want to make sure that you don't lose your peripheral vision. You want to be able to see the whole spectrum, you understand?
Yes, sir.
And so they put these drops in my eyes, and not just one set of drops, two sets of drops. And how many of you know that when they dilated, everything was too bright.
Yeah.
I couldn't even see straight.
Yes.
And I realized something, and God just showed me, said, the vision is never about you. And I began to think about that. I said, God, I want to be able to see like you want me to see.
Yes.
And it took some time before my vision began to clear up. And I began to see things clear. Glory to God.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah. Yes.
When we can envision the value of Holy Scripture, then we'll be able to see like God sees. We'll begin to think like God thinks. I want you to notice that in the text, Jesus referred to his disciples as fools.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Come on, yeah. You got to call them. Jesus called them fools.
Yes, sir.
Due to their failure to grasp the significance of his teachings,
yes,
and the fulfillment of the messianic prophecy. Let us not be considered fools or foolish,
yes,
by not knowing the scriptures. It was an open rebuke aimed at their spiritual dullness and inability to perceive the lack of vision and power of his resurrection.
Yes, sir.
The resurrection, this resurrection life should shape our daily decisions. It should shape our relationships. It should shape our priorities.
Yes, yes.
The resurrection, it is the foundation of our faith. Again, if there is no resurrection, we are most men miserable. We are all lost if there is no resurrection. Again, but when he rose, we rose.
Yes.
May the power of his resurrection,
yes,
Open our eyes and open my eyes that we may have this again fixed purpose to see as God sees.
Yes, sir.
My prayer for you this morning is that your heart burn. May your heart burn today as the scriptures come alive, as the scriptures become open, as they begin to give revelational knowledge. Last scripture, will you say it with me? Luke chapter 24, verse 32. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? Stand to your feet. I want to wish everyone a happy resurrection day. I make this offer of having a blessed resurrection day, but you know, there might be some among us who do not know Jesus, the Christ of God, for the pardoning of our sins. There may be one among us who could never have confessed him as the Lord Jesus Christ. There may be one among us who never knew or believed in their heart that Jesus, that God raised Jesus from the dead on the third day. You may be watching on the channel today. You may need to rededicate your life to the Lord today. You may be among us where you may need baptism of Holy Spirit with the evidence of praying in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. And fourthly, you may be here today and you don't have a church room. It is your responsibility as believers in the Most High God to have a place of worship, to have a place to be able to call home. If you're here today and any of these things apply to you, I will ask that you say this simple prayer with Harvest Christian Ministries International about your salvation, with every head bowed and every eye closed. Will you say this simple prayer with us? Father, I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, and that Father, you raised Jesus from the dead on the third day. He died for all of my sins, past, present, even future sins. I believe that in my heart. I want to live this life on your terms. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for loving me. In Jesus' name. Amen. We believe that salvation is that simple. It really is. There are no hoops that you have to jump through. I want you to consider the thief on the cross. There was one of them that said, you know, make railing accusations against the Lord. But there was a man on the cross who came to himself. He said, we deserve what we're getting. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life, and it's the man in the middle. That was my part. I said, but he came to himself. He said, we deserve this. And the Bible says he turned. And he said to the Lord Jesus, he says, remember me when you come into your Father's kingdom. Was he baptized? No. Did he pray in the Holy Ghost? No. Did he go to church?
No.
Jesus said today, he says, this day thou shalt be with me in paradise. Now, should we get baptized? Absolutely. Should we have the gift of praying in the Spirit? Absolutely. It's a gift. Should we be in a church? Absolutely. Forsaking not the gathering of ourselves, that we are obedient unto God. If that's you here today, if any of those four things apply to you, we have officers that are before the church right now. The doors of the church are open. We ask if that any of those things apply to you, will you please come? You may be watching online today. God sees your heart. He loves your decisions that you're making today to choose Jesus, the Christ of God as Savior. You know, lastly, if you're in need of prayer, at the end of this service, I'm going to come down here to the front, and I'm going to pray for everyone that comes that's in need of prayer. We're living in some tough times today. And sometimes you need a man of God. You need a woman of God in your life. You've been doing it your own way, and look where that's got you. We need to have someone to be able to speak over our lives, someone whom we can give the authority to shepherd over us. You know, Jesus is concerned about those who are not being shepherded. Father, it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that I thank you for giving me this opportunity to be able to share this gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We recognize that the immense road, university, that school is still in session. We pray that even before the day is over, Lord, that you will open our eyes and that you will open our ears and that you will give us a heart to understand the words, the scriptures, that revelation knowledge will be explosive on the inside of us today. And even if we have to pull over and give you glory, if we got to pull over and give you praise, but we'll do that. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. We make this declaration of faith that something good has already happened for you today. We'll say it again. Something good has already happened for you today. And it's in Jesus' name. And all the church said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. And remember that the harvest is truly ripe. Praise God. Amen. Amen.